Good morning, all. Welcome you to worship this morning. Glad to see you. Those of you joining us from home, glad that you can worship with us this morning. As we begin our new worship times, recently adjusted to 9 a.m. and 10:45, glad to have us able to be together this morning. Trust you were handed a bulletin or found one on your way in. They were there on the table as you entered. There are some announcements at the back of that, the last page of that bulletin. There are a couple of announcements, but just two events that I want to draw your attention to. One is this evening. I forgot to get it in the bulletin, but it is the first Sunday of the month, and so we are going to have a fellowship meal tonight. It'll be an outdoor fellowship meal at 5 o'clock, and there will be a fire pit, so you won't freeze. Would love for us to be able to gather together in that way, outside, be able to see each other, enjoy some fellowship together. So this evening, 5 o'clock, bring all your own dinner, but there will be a fire outside that we can enjoy together. So 5 o'clock this evening for a fellowship meal. The other event I want to make us aware of is Christmas Eve, traditional service for us every Christmas Eve. This year it's on Thursday, and our service of lessons and carols. For many of us, we're familiar with the Lessons and Carol service, but some may not be. It's a series of 9 scripture readings, each of which is followed by a song, a hymn that reflects something of that scripture reading. And we do that together as a church family on Christmas Eve to remind ourselves of the gospel story that we're a part of as followers of Christ. Why Jesus has come. What need we had that he came to meet, what needs we have had that he came to meet, and also looking forward to his second return when he comes to make all things new. So Christmas Eve, I think beginning at 6 o'clock, I think is what the time we have down for that, 6 o'clock, Christmas Eve. Usually we have a meal following that. We're not going to have a meal after that Lessons and Carol service this year, understandably. But would love for you and any family members that you have gathering with you potentially this year. We'll do that in person. We also will live stream it. So if you'd rather stay home around your own cozy fire with your people, you can do that and live stream our Lessons and Carol service Christmas Eve at 6 p.m. All our regular COVID protocols will be in place. We'll be seated every other row with masks and that sort of thing. But would love for you to be able to join us in some way in that worship service. We're going to move into worship now, and as we do that, I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to ask that God would be with us, enable us to hear from him and engage with him and with one another in worship. So if you would you bow with me for a word of prayer as we enter into worship? Our Father God, we thank you that you have given us breath this morning, that we might wake up and gather with your people, that we might have another day to live and to hopefully reflect your glory in this world. Thank you that this morning we can have the privilege of gathering together not only with folks in this room or online, but with people around the world who are seeking to love and honor Jesus this morning. So Father, help us as we worship you, that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. We might honor you both with the words of our mouths, but also the thoughts in our minds and the affections in our hearts, that all of who we are might be brought before your throne of grace, that might be sanctified by you, shaped by you, and that you might be pleased with our worship. So, Father, help us be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Beloved, if you would take your bulletins, let's stand together, and I will call us into worship on page 2 from Psalm 95, and then we'll join our voices together in song. Beloved, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation, for the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. Let's sing together.
Let us begin with the chorus, O come, let us.
O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him.
O come all ye faithful.
O come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. God of gods, light of light, lo, he abhors not the virgin's womb. Very God, God did not create it. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing choirs of angels, sing in exultation, sing all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God, in the highest. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Yea, Lord, we greet thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to thee be all glory. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him. O come, let us adore him.
All hail.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Crown him,
ye martyrs of your God, who from his altar call. Extol the stamp of Jesse's heart, and crown him Lord of all. Extol the stamp of Jesse's heart, and crown him Lord of all.
Ye seed of Israel's chosen race, ye ransomed from the fall.
With what then saved you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all.
Sinners whose love can never forget the wormwood and the gall, go spread your trophies at his feet and crown him.
trophies at his feet and crown him Lord of all.
Let every kindred,
every tribe on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
Oh, that with yonder
sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. For he is worthy, for he alone is worthy, for he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord.
All the glory
will give him all the glory. We'll give him all the glory. We'll give him all the glory, Christ the Lord.
Remain standing for our confession of faith this morning, taken from the New City Catechism, question 49, and then Ephesians 1 and Hebrews 7. Beloved, I ask you, where is Christ now? Christ rose bodily from the grave on the third day after his death, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, ruling his kingdom and interceding for us until he returns to judge and renew the whole world. God raised Jesus from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Amen. You may be seated. Let's go now to our God in prayer. Our Father, so much of our lives these days is not how they should be, not how we desire them to be. So much is out of feels out of joint and is leaves us discontent and frustrated and a little confused and unstable. Father, the instability in our lives is because of our own sin, the sins of others against us, but also because of the fact that we live in a fallen world that experiences all kinds of tensions and expressions of the brokenness that our sin has brought about. Father, so many longings and desires that we have for how things ought to be, how we want them to be, and we thank you that we have access now to you through Jesus. That these longings and desires we have, whether for physical wholeness and healing or for spiritual restoration to you or relational harmony in our marriages or in our workplaces and our families, our longings for a just society and for people to experience the goodness and the grace that you have for them. Father, all these longings we bring to you. We cannot affect the change in these ways in and of ourselves by our own efforts, so we lay ourselves and our longings before you. And we do so with deep gratitude because we have Jesus, our very flesh and blood, before you, interceding for us. We thank you that we have the Holy Spirit who intercedes for us as well, translating, as it were, our longings into words and expressions that in a way make sense to you, but you know us, and thank you that our sin and our brokenness is not too much, it's not too big of a chasm for you to get over. Thank you that you have come to us and rescued us out of our brokenness. That in Jesus we are seated at the throne with you. Thank you that in Jesus we have full assurance of acceptance. Thank you that in Jesus not only are our sins forgiven, but in Jesus our shame is covered with his righteousness. Thank you that in Jesus we have full assurance of acceptance with you, and so we can bring our longings and our desires, whether they be fully understood by us or not. Father, we can bring our groans to you. And because of your grace, you know exactly what they mean, and you know exactly what to do with them. So, Father, we entrust ourselves again to you, thankfully, humbly, honestly, because you have met our needs in the past. You have cared for us. You have sustained us through many a wilderness wandering. And so we have confidence that you will sustain us through today's wilderness wandering, through the wanderings of this season that we are in. And we look forward to the day when our Savior returns and makes all things new, when our faith is made sight and we no longer have to trust and have to hope, because we will have and we will be with you fully and finally and eternally. And so, Lord, we ask, as we bring our longings and our desires to you, we ask that you would come quickly, Lord Jesus, that all of our longings and desires might be satisfied and fulfilled in Christ. And so, Father, help us in this Advent season to be honest about our desires and our longings, to bring them all to you as we experience them, and to know that you love to hear from your children, and that you are at work in the world, conforming us to your image and enabling us then to be witnesses for you in this world in which we live. So help us to that end. Allow us to bring all of what we are to you, confident that you hear and that you care. and that you are at work transforming us, all to the praise of your glorious grace. In Jesus' name, amen. As part of our worship, we do receive an offering. We're not doing that here during this first service, but there is a box there in the back. If you've brought check or cash, you can drop it in there. The deacons will get it securely taken care of. Also, we can give online as an option. There's a link to that at our website, harvestpres.com/resources, is where you can find the link to online giving. As we are nearing the end of our fiscal year, we are still in the red, as it were, as a church, understandably in some ways because of the year that we've been in. But want to make sure that you're aware of ways that if you desire to, you have opportunity to give financially to the church. So please take advantage of those opportunities as the Lord leads you, and certainly do so with a grateful heart for who our God is and what he has done for us and continues to do. We turn our attention now to the preaching of God's word, and our passage this morning is Isaiah 43. Verses 8 through 15, you can find that there on page 5 of your bulletin, or I'd invite you to open up your Bible if you have a copy of it as well. It's funny the things that people can end up having in common. It's funny sometimes the people that end up having those things in common, not always who you would expect them to be. Take, for instance, these three people. It's unlikely that they would have anything in common. A relationally troubled woman, a notorious sinner. The whole town knows who she is, knows the kind of woman she is, and many in the town had actually been her husband at some point in the past. She is what we would call the definition of a hot mess. Then another man, crazy wealthy businessman. Crazy wealthy. He could wring every ounce of profit out of any transaction. And he did. He made a lot of money. He also made a lot of enemies as he stole from them. Then a third person, blue-collar worker, no formal education, rarely had two coins of his own that he could rub together. Always smelling of hard work and sweat. What could these three possibly have in common? Once again, in Isaiah's prophecy, we're taken into a courtroom scene. And in this scene of the courtroom, verses 8 and following, witnesses are being called. Witnesses are being called to give testimony. To give testimony to which God is able to predict the future and then enact that future. Witnesses are being called to give testimony to which God can redeem, can deliver and save a whole people to himself. Witnesses are being called to give testimony to which God out there is able to be known intimately by that people that he saves. Witnesses are being called to give testimony to whether or not the God of the Bible is who he says he is. And we might be surprised by the witnesses that God calls. Isaiah 43, 8 through 15. Bring out the people who are blind, yet have eyes, who are deaf, yet have ears. All the nations gather together and the peoples assemble. Who among them can declare this and show us the former things? Let them bring their witnesses and prove them right. Let them hear and say, it is true. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me. And understand that I am he. Before me, no God was formed, nor shall there be any after me. I am the Lord, and besides me, there is no Savior. I declared and saved and proclaimed when there was no strange God among you, and you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. And henceforth I am also, henceforth I am he. There is none who can deliver from my hand. I work, and who can turn it back? Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your sake I send to Babylon and bring them all down as fugitives, even the Chaldeans, in the ships in which they rejoice. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Beloved, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together. Our Father, we do ask for your blessing to be added now by your Spirit to this portion of your word read and preached, that we might bear witness to you, to your grace, to your glory, to your goodness, to your character, so that the nations might come and that they might see the light and be brought into the family to the praise of your glorious grace. In Jesus' name, amen. We begin this morning with who God is. Whenever reading a passage of Scripture, that's usually a good place to start. What does this text tell me about God? What would this text have me know about God? Who he is, what he's done, what he promises to do, even as we saw last week from the first seven verses of this passage. So we begin this morning with who God is. A number of times in just these verses, the Lord tells us, I am. This ought to be familiar language to those of us that know the Bible, but if we don't know the Bible, if we're new to Christianity or to reading the Bible, when God says, I am, that means something. It means we need to listen. We need to pay attention. This is the God who created all things revealing himself, telling us about himself. And we have a number of these I am statements here in our verses. One shows up in verse 10, the latter portion of verse 10, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. This is the Lord saying, I am the God who is. I am the one. And that I am the God who is knowable. He says that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. The God who is a knowable God. God wants us to know that we can know him, that we can be in relationship with him. There in verse 11, then we read, I am the Lord. I am, that is, Yahweh. As we saw last week and have seen previously, that phrase, the Lord, it's a relational term. It's God's covenant name. It's the name by which he revealed himself to his particular people. I am the Lord, and besides me, there is no Savior. That is to say, the Lord is telling us, I am Yahweh. I am the covenant God. I am the one who has saved you. I am the one who has delivered you into relationship with myself. One of the things that the Bible is insistent that we would know is it isn't just that we're saved from something, hell and eternity apart from God. We are saved to something as well. We are saved to relationship with God. This God, the God who is a knowable, saving, delivering God. The end of verse 12. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and I am God. That's a definitive truth claim. I am God. Elsewhere in Isaiah chapters 45 and 46, especially, we see God saying, I am God and there is no other. There is no other God. God is not uncomfortable being this definitive. I am God and there is no other. In verse 13, we have more, and also henceforth I am he. Not only has God been, not only is God now, but God will be. This is God speaking about the future and who he will be in the future. Henceforth, from now on, I am he. This speaks to God's eternality, that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it speaks to his power. I have been, I am, and I will be. Don't forget, God is telling us, I'm the one that has done all these things for you. Verse 14, thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Now, not explicitly an I am statement, but certainly a statement about the Lord's character and who he is. Your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. This is who God is. In verse 15, we have a summary of who the Lord is. I am the Lord. Again, the covenant God who is knowable. Your Holy One. I am your Holy One. I am the Creator of Israel. I am your King. This is who God is. This is massive language, the Holy One, the Creator, the King, but it's also personal language, your Holy One, your Creator, your King. One of the things that God is insistent on here, and it may seem subtle to us, it may not be the first thing we pick up as we read through this section, but God wants us to see that he is a relational, knowable God. It's not only that he exists and that he is, but he is knowable. He is a God who created us for relationship with him. This is the God with whom we have to do, the God with whom we are in relationship. And throughout this section of Isaiah, God continues reminding his people of who he is. If you were to read a large chunk of the end of Isaiah, or listen to it as I occasionally do. It's helpful to listen to the scriptures sometimes. If you were to listen to 5, 6, 7, 8 chapters at one time, you'd be impressed, I would think, with how often God talks about himself. How consistently he reminds his people of who he is and what he's done for them and what he promises yet to do. And the reason for that is because we need something stable. We need something certain, something that we can ground ourselves in. You see, for God's people, God is true north. He's the referent point. He is our foundation. He is our stability. And we are given to shakiness. We are given to fearfulness. We are given to instability. And God knows that about us. And so he reminds us time and time and time again about who he is and what he's done. Eyes back on me, he says. Eyes back on me. In the midst of so much uncertainty, we need something. We need someone who never changes. Beloved, part of, I think, one of the main things that leads to our feeling unsteady in the midst of hard days or difficulty is that we're looking to the wrong things for our stability. We're looking to find stability in another human relationship. We're looking to find stability, our core fundamental stability in an organization like the church or a government or a job or our children even. These are all good things, but none of them is stable enough for the weight of your soul. So God reminds us of himself, who he is, to restabilize us in the midst of uncertain times. Remember, God's people, as Isaiah writes to them, are in exile They're away from their normal worship routines. They're away from their normal employment. They're away from their normal family connections. They're in a new city, hundreds of miles away from home. Everything is up in the air, except for who God is. God is the one unchangeable factor in your life. And beloved, we have access to this knowable, unchangeable God in the person and work of Jesus Christ. This is the beauty of one of the beautiful things about Advent is it reminds us of the grand narrative of what's actually going on in the world, that there is a God out there who created all things, and that God is knowable. He's not knowable as we work our way up to him, ever getting better and better and better and morally capable of knowing God. It's not that we have to attain to some height to come to a knowledge of God. It's that God has come to us in the person of Jesus Christ to bridge the gap, as it were, for us, because we cannot bridge the gap ourselves. All the promises of God find their yes and their amen in Jesus Christ. And if we know Jesus by faith, if Jesus is your personal Lord and Savior, this God to whom Isaiah is referring is your God. You can read Isaiah 43:15 and take it personally. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the creator of my people, your King. But if you don't know Jesus by faith, you are outside of relationship with God. You do not have access to these very great and precious promises. But it doesn't have to stay that way. Because one of the beautiful things about this God is he is ever redeeming, ever saving, ever delivering, ever rescuing, ever coming to those who are lost, ever saying to them, come home, come to me and be at rest. So even today, you can come into this relationship, bowing the knee to King Jesus, submitting your life to the God who made all things. Today can be the day where you gain access to God the Father by the power of God the Holy Spirit through God the Son. Give yourself to him. Be forgiven of your sins and know the hope of eternal life, even today. The Lord says to us here in Isaiah 43, I am God. I am your God. Therefore, you are. Who we are as God's people is grounded in who the Lord is. These I am statements that God makes in Isaiah 43 are connected then to the you are statements that apply to us. And there's two things that we are, according to this passage, as God's people, as followers of Jesus Christ. What are we to be? What are we to do? The first thing is, you are to know me, God says. You are to know me. Look in verse 10. God says, you are my witnesses. And yes, that's point number two about who we are and what we are to be, witnesses. But first, you are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant, whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. The purpose statement is that you may know and believe and understand. That's the first thing. God has delivered us, rescued us, chosen us, called us, redeemed us, so that we might know him. That's the purpose of our redemption. To know him. To believe him. To understand him. I mean, this is a multifaceted reality, isn't it? It isn't just that we come to know facts about him. Biblical knowing is much deeper and richer than merely intellectual assent. It's not less than intellectual assent, but it is most certainly more than. To know biblically is a deep and rich and full experience. It isn't just knowing facts about someone, it's knowing someone. Listen to how Jesus himself speaks about knowing God. In John 17, Jesus says, "This is eternal life." In prayer to the Father, Jesus says, "This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent." Jesus summarizes the reality of eternal life and the offer of eternal life given to us in the gospel by language of knowing God. Eternal life is knowing the Father and Jesus Christ whom he has sent. I wonder if we think about our Christian life in terms of knowing God. I know that most of the time that is not my default mode. My default mode goes to tasks, things that need to be done. But biblically, knowing is not primarily a task orientation. Biblically, our redemption is about relationship, right? That's what we saw as we looked at who God is. I am your God, that you might know me. Our relationship with God is primarily relational, not informational or transactional. It isn't just that God wants us to agree to a certain list of facts. It's not just that he wants to, and that would be merely intellectual. And it isn't just that he wants us to do a bunch of stuff, like he's exacting some product from us, the transactional aspect. But it's this deeper, richer relational aspect. Now, granted that we all three of those are it's not an either or here. Biblical knowing is deep and rich. Consider the prophet Jeremiah in chapter 9 says to us, "Let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness." The Apostle John in chapter 5 of his first letter says to us, "We know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding." So this sounds intellectual, right? Like, we know that Jesus came and he's given us understanding. Got it. But listen to where John goes. "So that we may know him who is true." Do you see how John goes from the facts of who Jesus is and what he's done to the relationship underneath it or beyond it? "We know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding, so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life." You see, Jesus is the fulfillment of Isaiah 43. This relationship between God and people it culminates in the person and work of Jesus Christ. You see, beloved, the primary call of the Christian and the ongoing invitation to the unchristian, the lost, is to know God through Jesus Christ. That's what this is about. Not primarily knowing about Jesus Christ, the facts of, but as we know the facts and come to know the facts of who Jesus is and what he's done, that we might come to know him and be in relationship with him. Biblically, knowing is not merely or even primarily informational. Knowing is relational. Sadly, many of us, and I myself included, have contented themselves with the merely factual, informational knowing. Facts about. But oftentimes we fail to press on into the deeper, richer, fuller, relational knowing. I fall into this in my own relationship with my wife. Just the facts, ma'am. We were joking about that this week. The deeper, richer, biblical knowing is relational. It doesn't ignore facts, but it presses through them, beyond them, to get to know the person. So it is in our relationship with God through Christ. This is the Apostle Paul's desire in Philippians chapter 3, right? Verses 8 through 10, he considers everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of what? Of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, there the Apostle Paul says, I decided to know nothing among you except what? No, check that. Except whom? I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul didn't come to the Corinthians wanting to know all the details and all the facts about the sports teams in Corinth and who had the best record. He didn't come just to know the details of their economics and their social issues. He came to know Jesus. And that changes everything. This is why Hosea the prophet in chapter 6 of his prophecy tells us, let us know, let us press on to know the Lord. There are many who know lots of facts about God, but they don't know God. There are many who would proclaim to be biblical scholars, but they don't know Jesus. They may have letters after their name and have written any number of books, even on the Gospels, but they don't know the good news. And so too, on the other hand, there may be those who know very little about the details of theology or about the details even of Jesus' life, but they know more of Jesus than you and me combined. Relational knowing is what the Bible is after. It's what the gospel is after. You are first and foremost, beloved, Jesus says to us, to know me. The purpose of our redemption is to know God and then to make him known. To know God and to make him known. Because of who he is and what he's done, that is our call. And we see that call to make God known in our text a number of places. This chapter paints a courtroom scene with witnesses being called. And look who it is that God calls to be his witnesses, to testify on his behalf. Verse 10 and 12, you are my witnesses. This is what the Creator, the Eternal, the Redeeming, Delivering God says to people who are in exile. The biblical narrative tells us there was about 4,000 people that were taken from Jerusalem into exile. They had dwindled down from 2 million people when they left slavery in Egypt, when God initially rescued them in the book of Exodus. There were about 2 million, scholars estimate. 2 million people who now, hundreds of years later, have dwindled down to about 4,000. They were small to begin with as a people, and now they're trivial and insignificant, and they're in exile. They're powerless. They're oppressed by other people, and God says, you are my witnesses. You are the ones that I choose to testify about me and my power in this world. You are my witnesses. If you know God through faith in Jesus Christ, you are his witness. It's not up for debate. Because God has said, if you know me, you are my witness. It isn't just the super saints, the celebrity preachers. It isn't just the godly martyrs. It's the regular, normal, run-of-the-mill follower of Jesus that God said, to whom God says, you are my witness. This is how God works. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, God says he takes the weak things in the world to shame the strong. Are you weak? Praise God. You're who he wants. He takes the foolish things in the world to shame the wise. You feel foolish sometimes? Praise God. You're who God wants. Are you broken? Praise God. That's who he uses to demonstrate his wholeness. Because we're his witnesses. He owns us. We testify about him and his glory and his power and his goodness. Making God known, being his witness. It isn't just in word that we do that. It's not just with our words that we testify about who God is and what he's done. That may be what we think of first. We may think of to be a witness, to be a testifier about God means you have to be really good at evangelism. You have to have 14 scripture passages and have them all marked out exactly right in your mind so that you can trace someone through. That's great. If you can do that, praise the Lord. That's wonderful. But that isn't the only way that God calls us to be witnesses. With our words, yes. We are all called as followers of Christ to be able to, if given an opportunity, to give testimony to the hope that we profess. So we do need to use our words. But beloved, I wonder if in emphasizing the use of our words to testify to who God is and what he's done, we've neglected two other ways that we are to testify to who God is and what he's done. Of course, our actions are one of those. Not just what do we say, but what do we do? What we do testifies to who God is, that we are his, that we're being made new by him and in him. So our words and our actions, absolutely. Yes, these two are testifiers to who God is and what he's done. And so we must be attentive to our behavior in the public realm. How do we carry ourselves? What do we do? What things don't we do? All of that is a testimony to who God is and what he's done. We are his witnesses, whether we're aware of it in any given moment or not. We are his witnesses. If people come to know you and they come to know that you're a follower of Christ, they are watching you. And some of you know that very well. They have their eye on you. You're being watched. But there's a third way that I know personally I have neglected. And one of my great fears is that in pastoring a church, I've caused the church to neglect it too. Our words, yes. Our actions, yes. And also our tone testifies to God. Not just what we say and what we do, but how we say and how we do is as much a testimony to God as the things we say and the things we do. Beloved, our tone matters. It's easy to think we're defending the truth and to do so arrogantly and obnoxiously. What kind of witness is that? What kind of testimony to the grace and kindness of a redeeming Savior to be an arrogant jerk? I'm describing myself. I think for many of us, we have the words down. Many of us, we know the facts of the gospel. You might be able to draw the bridge diagram and walk somebody through it. Praise God. May you have opportunity this week to do that. Many of you demonstrate the gospel beautifully with your generosity and your kindness, the things you do sacrificially for the benefit of other people. It's a testimony to the grace of God. And there are those of you that are especially gifted with a kind and generous tone from whom I have learned and need to continue learning. We can speak the truth compassionately, understanding that I too am a sinner. I too am broken. And if it weren't for the grace of God entering into my life and rescuing me, what kind of person would I be? What we say and what we do and how we say and do all testify to God. I am the Lord, your Redeemer. You are my witnesses. You remember the hot mess lady? She'd had 5 husbands, and the man she was currently sleeping with was not her husband. And Jesus met her, and he changed her. And this notorious sinner went back to the town she came from and told everybody about him. John chapter 4 tells us that Jesus met this Samaritan woman at a well, and they had a theological conversation that wasn't really theological. It was really about who she was and what she needed. And Jesus met her there, changed her. And she couldn't help herself. The same people that earlier in the day she probably had blushed in front of and gone to the well at the time when nobody else would be there, so that she wouldn't have to interact with other people, so that her shame could be hidden. Now she went back to those people and said, "You've got to come meet this guy. He told me everything I ever did." Which maybe to their ears wouldn't have been very impressive, because everybody already knew what she'd already done. But the fact that here's a woman who has every right to be ashamed of herself in their eyes has now come to them and said, "You've got to meet this guy." And wouldn't you know they do? She became a witness. And that wealthy businessman, Zacchaeus by name, right? He made all his money by exacting, stealing from other people their taxes. But Jesus showed up at Zacchaeus' house and changed him. And this man who had been crazy wealthy because he'd abused other people financially became crazy generous. He gave his money away. He became a witness, a testifier to this Jesus. And that man, that blue-collar worker, Peter, he was a fisherman, smelly, uneducated, but he'd met Jesus, and Jesus changed him. And after Jesus' death and resurrection, this Peter is given God's Holy Spirit, as all who are met by Jesus and changed by him are. Peter was a changed man. And so this uneducated fisherman now is going around by the power of Jesus, doing miracles, healing people, and preaching powerfully. And in Acts chapter 4, beginning in verse 7, we read, "When the religious leaders had set Peter and John in the midst of them, they inquired of them, 'By what power or by what name do you do this? Heal this man.' Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, 'Rulers of the people and elders, if we're being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him, this man is standing before you well.'" You hear the facts of Peter's just giving him the facts. In verse 11, "This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there's no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." You see, Peter gives them the facts. But he's also doing the work of witnessing. He healed this man by the power of the Spirit, and now he's standing up with his words, demonstrating, witnessing, testifying. The text continues, "Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated common men, the religious leaders were astonished, and they recognized that these men had been with Jesus. But seeing the man who was healed standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition." When our words and our actions and our tone come together to testify to the grace of Jesus, people will be changed. God will be glorified even through the likes of me and you. Beloved, God says to us, to you who are in Jesus Christ today, "You are my witnesses." We are in the courtroom of eternity, in, as it were, the trial for divinity, and we are God's witnesses. We are the ones to whom he has entrusted the testimony, me and you. And no two of us will be exactly alike. But we're all telling, sharing, showing the same one God, the same glorious gospel. Simply know God, and in that knowing, beloved, you will be changed. And that change will lead you to make God known with your words, with your actions, and even with your tone, representing the grace of the living God. Beloved, we are his witnesses. Let's pray. So, Father, help us to be. Help us to be faithful. Help us to be attentive to our words and our actions and the tone with which we say and do them, so that all these things might conspire against the evil one and against his hold on this world, that we might participate with you in bashing against the gates of hell and so bring you glory. Father, help us to that end. Even this week, give us opportunity to be your witnesses to the praise of your glorious grace. Amen. There's lots of ads and content out there in our world about things that you should eat to have better gut health and improve your memory and all these sorts of things. And I guess the principle there makes sense, and it's true that what goes in helps shape you, and you are what you eat, as they say. That's not untrue spiritually. Beloved, you are what you eat spiritually. So the question is, what are you feeding on? What are you feeding on? The world wants to feed us all kinds of trash and all kinds of garbage. Gets our spiritual cholesterol up and gets our spiritual blood sugar all out of whack. Maybe I'm pushing that metaphor too far, but I don't know that I am. God feeds us with himself. Living bread. True nourishment. Jesus the Savior. So if you know Christ, in order to know him more fully, feed on him. Get to know him as he offers himself to you. Beloved, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." As often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. How we live in the present is grounded in the past and hopeful for the future. Jesus nourishes us on those truths. So if you know Christ, this meal is for you. We welcome you, encourage you. Please eat it. drink of it, and be nourished by Jesus. But if you don't know Christ this morning, we would warn you on the authority of the scriptures, don't take this meal, but instead take Jesus by faith. Come to know him, have life in him. Tell us about it. And then we would love to welcome you to this table as members of the body of Christ. Let's pray together. Father, thank you that you know us. You know what we need, and so you provide for us Jesus. So would you apply this common, simple meal to us powerfully by your Spirit, that we might be your witnesses more fully and more faithfully. Through Jesus our Savior, we ask it. Amen. When you're prepared to do so and appropriately masked, you can grab your communion supplies from one of the four tables here in the room, and then we will all take the elements together once everyone has received. Beloved, this bread which we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ, your Savior? Taste, see. And so too, this cup of blessing which we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? Taste. Faithful God and King, we thank you that you are, and that you have called us into relationship with yourself by the blood of Jesus. Father, keep us, sustain us, nourish us until that great day when we see you face to face. So come quickly, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen. Beloved, let's stand together, and if you're as you're able, and we'll close our service in song. Hark the Herald Angels Sing, found there on page 7. Of your bulletin, or page 203 in the hymnal. Let's stand together and sing.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy. By highest head adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb, veiled in flesh the Godhead see, veiled incarnate Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the ham-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings. Thank you.
it's been good to be with you this morning, and I invite you as we head out now to receive the Lord's good word, his benediction to you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. May he be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace today and forevermore through Jesus, our King and our Savior. God's people said together, amen.